So hope everybody had a good week. This is actually going to be the last Bible study I do for this year, because I go out of town next Thursday, and I'll be at the airport at that time, and then I come back on a Thursday at the same time. So this will be the last one, and we'll pick back up in January. But I'm glad that everybody's on. I'm glad, Jesus, glad to see you on, brother. Brenda, Jody, Michalina, Cody, my mother-in-law, David. Happy to see all you guys on here. Why does my screen keep doing that? So just glad everybody's on. Tonight is a very super important message. It's a very important yet a very powerful message. It's something the Lord. I have a preaching that I'm gonna preach, but before I get into the preaching, this is something like the Lord has been putting in my spirit, something that He's actually confirmed through other pastors and other ministers that I respect highly. Of the things that are to come in the year of 2022, and this is not to scare anybody or make anybody worry, but it's just I have to share it. The Bible says that we're supposed to be watchtowers. We see something coming, we're supposed to alarm the people. But I'm sure everybody's seen what's going on in the world, that there was five tornadoes that just went through a bunch of a bunch of tornadoes that just went through like five states and killed a bunch of people. And the news is reporting that there's never been anything like that ever in the history of checking tornadoes and recording them, of how many disasters is going on. And now it started up in Colorado. It's starting up in all these different states, multiple tornadoes and catastrophe happening, but at the same time, and that's never happened before. You know, you'll hear about one or two tornadoes go through somewhere and then that's it, but it's happening. I think it was reported in one day over 50 tornadoes going on at the same time. And they said they'd never seen nothing like this before. And there's like a lot of events that's going on. I guess a lot of churches probably won't share about it or talk about it, but I will. I believe, like I said, whoever who's been on this Bible studies before, I believe we're in the last days. I believe that what the Bible says we will see before the Christ comes back for His church, we're starting to see some of those things, and it's a lot closer than what we think. I'm going to share a couple of things that happened. So while all these things were going on, tornadoes, killing people, all these things going on, I was in my my work truck at work. My truck was shaking up. The winds were shaking up my truck. I'm like, why? And I just seen trees getting knocked over. And this is here, in Florida. So that was going on. I don't know, something in my spirit just told me something right is not going on. Something's going to happen. And I just said, all right, God, maybe it's just me just thinking into it too much. But I just in prayer, the Lord just showed me that next year we're going to see a lot of Bible prophecy come to pass. I believe there's going to be a lot of natural disasters happen. I believe in the economy, a lot of things are going to happen. And we as Christians, we got to be prepared for it. And this isn't for something for you to get scared or to be filled with fear. For the Bible says God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. But it's something that you should be aware of and that you should prepare for. Because you look at the Bible, when God was going to destroy the earth, he gave Noah a heads up. You look at multiple stories in the Bible, when God was going to happen, bad things were going to happen in the world, he gave his people a heads up. So I believe God is giving us a heads up that just prepare that next year, I believe a lot of things, crazy things, if you think the COVID thing was bad or whatever was going on was bad, this is nothing of what is to come. I believe some biblical things are going to happen, and us as the body of Christ, we got to be ready. We got to be ready for Jesus. We got to be ready for his coming, because we won't be here too much longer. One of the things that happened, which I'm going to share a picture on it, and I'm sure maybe some people haven't seen it, and if you're not, don't worry, I'm going to show it now. In the book of Revelation, the Bible says that in the last days, there'll be an antichrist, pretty much a man that's possessed with the devil, who will take over the entire world. And the Bible gives three references of three things. He says, and I'm sure everyone's heard the mark of the beast, which everyone's going to take, the 666, but explains two beasts and a dragon. One of the beasts It explains it's going to have different animal parts, but it's not because it's an actual like monster out of a movie that comes out. It's symbolic of many nations that are going to come together and create this beast that is going to help the Antichrist pretty much rule the world. And the Bible explains this in the book of Revelation, I believe chapter 13, and explains what this beast looks like. And then explains that there's going to be a second one, which is the actual Antichrist. And then it explains there's a dragon who will give power to these two beasts, which represents Satan. So, and the Bible says that in the last days, it says people will worship the image of the beast. And, you know, and that's when the Antichrist said that people will worship this. And that's how you know that we're in the last days. Well, I saw in the news somebody from Mexico, somebody, I don't know who he is, but a rich guy just built one of the statues that represents the beast in the book of Revelation that represents, you know, the many nations that will get together to support the Antichrist. And what a coincidence. They built this thing and they put it in front of the United Nations building. So us as Christians, we got to be aware about what's going on in the days we're living in. Jesus said that you got to be aware, you got to be vigilant because the enemy is looking to see who he can devour. So they built this beast. I'm going to show you right now. Let me share my screen so you guys can see what it looks like. Can you guys see this or is it too small? Can you guys see it or is it too small? Anybody?
We can see it, but it's small.
But can you see it decent enough? Because I think the picture is just small.
Try to zoom it in a little bit more.
I think that's, yeah, I can see it.
It's a little blurry. All right. So in the picture, you can see it has the body of a bear, the face of a lion, the wings. I mean, if you look at the book, it fits the same description that the book of Revelation said that is the beast that represents the many nations that will come together to support the Antichrist. Well, it's in front of the United Nations, which is many nations that come together. They just built it and they just put it in front of there. Why would you build something that represents the Antichrist? You know, that's because these people are already putting things in place for the Antichrist. So they just put that there. And if people think, no, maybe it's just a coincidence, they named this beast, they named it the Guardian of Peace and Security. In the book of Thessalonians, it says in the last days, you will hear them, meaning the world, the people, are going to, it says, yell peace and security, but then there will be sudden destruction. That's in the book of 1 Thessalonians. So they named this thing the Guardian of Peace and Security. You're going to tell me that's not a coincidence? That's Bible prophecy coming to pass. If that's what it says, right now is the time to live for God, live for Christ. Because they just put that there at the United Nations. They named it after scripture. And like I said, this is some scary times. Now I'm going to show you another image because there's a second beast. The Bible says there's two beasts. This picture is way better. So the Bible says there's two beasts in the book of Revelation. And this is, they put another one there too. And I didn't save the other picture. But there's another picture of the dragon. They put it in front of the Rockefeller Center in New York. And they put it there, which anybody knows those people are involved with satanic stuff. So all that stuff is going on. And so when I was looking at this stuff, I was like, all right, you know, let me Google Earth it just so no one says that this isn't real, it's not there. So I went to Google Earth to try to, and I put the direction, the location, my phone, as soon as I was looking for it, my phone froze, the screen went black, and my phone shut off by itself. So my phone has never done that. My phone has never froze. My screen's never gone black, never, not even once. And my phone has never shut itself off. It did it by itself. So I was like, and I mean, I got chills when that happened. And I believe that was the the devil not wanting me to see what's going on. So give me one second. So the devil didn't want me to see what's going on, so I don't warn people about what's going on. And I'm not gonna lie to you, it was super creepy. I got a little bit shook up. But you know, that's what's going on in this world, you know, just to, before I get into the preaching. And when I seen this, I prayed and I said, Lord, you know, if there's something going on that you want me to know, and I just feel in my spirit that, you know, just make sure you're right with God, make sure you're in a good place spiritually. And also just make sure on a physical place that you are, you know, prepared, that you got a good plan if something was to happen, because I had felt it in my spirit. And when I felt it in my spirit, I was actually sharing it with Miguelina, who's on here. I was talking about it and she's a witness. Then I went on Facebook and this preacher that I respect highly, his name is Perry Stone. If you watch his YouTube videos, tremendous man of God, been in ministry for like 50, 60 years. And he said he felt the same in his spirit, that we're about to see some crazy things that the world has never seen before. That's fulfilling Bible prophecy, because we're in the last days. So I just wanted to share that with you guys real quick. You know, it's not something to scare you, but just know that we're in the last days, and just make sure you're in the best place with God and spiritually, and just be prepared. Be prepared, because Jesus is coming back a lot sooner than what we think. We've never seen stuff like this before. And like I said, in my spirit, I just know something that we haven't seen before is going to start to happen in this coming year. But anyways, let's get to the message. So the message that God gave me, like I said, this is the last Bible study that I'm doing for the year. I'll be going out of town next Thursday, and I won't be returning until that same Thursday, so I won't be able to do the Bible study. But it's very important, this message, because we're going into 2022, and even though I said that all these Bible prophecies and all these things are going to happen, it's still going to be a good year for God's, keyword, God's people. Because though all this stuff may happen in the world, God always protects his people. God always looks out for his people. God will always provide for his people. And God's just always going to bless his people. The world doesn't dictate our blessing. The world doesn't dictate our protection. The Lord does. So just know that there's going to be some good things coming, I believe. Those who remain faithful, the Bible says, those who remain faithful to the end, like, God is going to take care of you. God is going to bless you. God is going to handle your situation. God is going to fix your problems. And Filiberto said, that's an alegría. It's a demon that goes from the dead to the living, kind of like CERN. It's an old Mexican. Yeah, it was made in Mexico. He's talking about the beast that was there. It was a Mexican that built it. But if it's... you even confirmed that even in the Mexican culture, it's considered a demon from the dead. Yeah, they were calling it because it's from the Dia de los Muertos, but it's an actually fulfills the description the book of Revelation talks about. So not a coincidence that it's representing the devil. So like I said, you see all this demonic devil worship. It's getting glorified on media, rappers, songs. People freely talk about making pacts with the devil, and people think it's funny. People think it's funny. They think it's a joke. They take it lightly. I think those two guys that everybody keeps sharing, the Island Boys, they're hilarious. I think they're corny. But these guys talk about giving their life to the devil. I mean, we're living in the last days. The Bible says that the hearts of many will grow cold. People killing each other left and right. They have no remorse for it. And the world, the government's putting this diabolical stuff, this anti-Christ agenda, it's in our face. And the people still think that Jesus isn't coming back. They still think, hey, you can live however you want. And God's just like, oh, I believe in Christ. Like, that's not enough. The Bible says that he's going to tell those who are going to go into heaven, my good and faithful servant. He didn't say, my good and faithful, I say I believe in Jesus. Or my good and faithful, I go to church. He said, my servant. So you got to have a heart of a servant and start serving the Lord, you know. So I believe, like I said, in the year 2022, we're going to see some crazy prophetic things. I believe, like I said, we're going to see probably natural disasters that we've never seen before. We're going to start to see the economic collapse. But guess what? The good thing is for us as Christians, we're protected from these things. Us as believers, God looks out for us. But it's just things to be alert, things that when it happens, don't be alarmed, don't be scared, but just say, because I see these things happening, my Redeemer lives, my Lord Jesus Christ, he's coming back. He's coming back for me. And like I said, and you got to warn people. You got to warn people. The Bible says you got to tell people, man, Jesus is coming back. Tell them of what this government is doing with the world. I'm telling you, when I started researching these things, my phone shut off by itself and my hair stood up and I said, whoa. And I just felt this demonic presence. That's how I know the devil was upset that I was, watching what he was doing. But anyways, going into the year 2022 is super important. And the title of this message is called Don't Look Back. Super important, because in order to proceed in life, in order to get to the next level, in order to get ahead, you can't look back. And what I mean by don't look back, meaning you can't be paying attention to the past no more. Sometimes we get stuck in life because of the past. You think about good memory, whether it's a good memory of the past that you hold on to, and you say, man, those were the good days. And as if those days are better than what you're living now. Or you say, man, I miss where I used to live, or I used to miss this relationship I used to be in, or I'm this, or I used to go here and do that. And it brings this depression and sadness and this loneliness. Or you have this fear of failure of the past, of this is going wrong this year. And I'm afraid that 2022, these things are going to either keep happen again, or get worse. You may say, oh, 2022 is going to be a bad year for me, or I'm worried about my kids, I'm worried about my financial situation, I'm worried about my job. Things are going to get worse from here. And you're looking back because of past failures or past things that have gone wrong. And you're worried, if you keep looking at these things, it's going to be very difficult for you to move forward. It's going to be very difficult to receive the new thing that God is trying to do in your life in this coming year of 2022. And you're going to miss out on it if you're living in the past. You're going to miss out on it if you keep looking towards what used to happen, or things that happened before, things that are behind you, you know. And even you say, oh, but these things ain't behind me, they're happening still today. Well, guess what? Today will become the past tomorrow. So even though it may happen yesterday, that is still the past. What happened yesterday, the day before, what's even going on now, that doesn't have to be the case for your life for the year of 2022. I believe 2022 is going to be a good year for those who are living right for God, that serve the Lord, and they're doing the best that you can for God. God's going to resolve. God's going to bless. God's going to give you things that you thought you'd never have. He's just going to bless you. And like I said, even though I believe the world is going to go in a very chaos mode next year, us as God's people, that's what makes us different from the world. When everyone's freaking out about the economy and this and that, we will have our peace. Because God is our peace, God is our provider, and everything's going to be fine. But the key thing, and this is the message tonight, is do not look back. We're tempted to look back sometimes. Old memories, past relationships, maybe old friendships, past failures, or maybe the good old days. The enemy loves to use our past or history to prevent us from doing what we need to do to move forward towards God's best in the future. Sometimes it's used to make you feel like you failed before and you will fail again. Or maybe it's used to make you miss things from before, as if what God has, as if what God has isn't going to be better than what you used to have or how things used to be. Or maybe it's used in the way that bad things that happened to you before will continue to happen to you again, or that you will go back to the person that you used to be, doing the things you used to do that you shouldn't. In whichever way the enemy uses the past against you, you cannot look back. I think everybody, in some way or another, we look back. Whether it's missing an old relationship, missing an old friendship, missing where old job, where you used to be, where you used to live, or, you know, how you used to be as a person, and you're just looking towards the past, things from your history. And it's a very dangerous thing. And we're going to look here in the scripture why God doesn't want us to look towards the past for no reason. Some people say, oh, but I like to look at my past, see how far. You don't have to do that. You don't have to look to see how far along you've come. You know how far along you've come. You don't got to look back, because it's a dangerous thing, because you may look back and it may do more than you thought it was going to do. So why is it so dangerous to look back at the past? There are many stories in the Bible when a person looked back to the past or to old ways or old things or, you know, situations, and it destroyed their life. Looking back prevents you from looking forward. If you're not focused on what's ahead, you will never get there. That's like if you're driving, you're trying to get to a destination. How are you going to drive looking at the rearview mirror? You're going to get into an accident. You're going to crash. You got to look forward. You got to look forward. You say, man, 2022, I have something to look forward to. 2022, this is going to be a very good year for me. It's going to be a fruitful year for me. This is going to be the year that my financial situation changes. It may have been bad before, and maybe it's been bad a couple years. And maybe you said, I made a New Year's resolution and my situation stayed the same. But when you put things before Christ, you put things before Christ, you can make all the New Year's resolution you want, and it's just not going to change. You have to put Christ as number one. If you want to change in your 2022, you can't look back. Say, this thing's happened to me before. Well, 2022, it doesn't have to be like that for you. Or maybe I'm single. It doesn't have to be. You don't got to be single 2022. Maybe your marriage went through some bumpy roads. Don't have to be that way. You got to leave the past in the past. Like I said, today will become the past tomorrow. So even from today, going back, whatever is your current situation is going on, maybe with your children, with your kids, your family, whatever it may be, even with your health, you got to leave it in the past. And look forward. Into the thing is, the enemy gets us so stuck on our past and all these things, so we don't reach where God wants us to reach for the future. So there's many things that'll do to you. The first thing is, looking back freezes you and it paralyzes you, and you'll get stuck in your life if you're looking back towards the past, things that happened before. There's a story that I'm going to get into. It. It's in the book of Genesis, chapter 19. I'll give you a quick little briefing before we read it. It's about the story of Sodom and Gomorrah. If you never read it, I suggest you read it, because the Bible says that the last days will look a lot like the days of Sodom and Gomorrah. So Sodom and Gomorrah was two cities that were before Jesus's time. The Bible says that it got so wicked, people were rioting. Sin was at an all-time high. I mean, homosexuality, all that stuff that was going on, is nothing new. This was happening back then too, and this was at an all-time high in these two cities. And this stuff was going on, and God said, I'm fed up with these people. I'm gonna destroy it. And God was gonna destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. But in those two cities, there was a man of God, and he had a family, he had a wife, he had kids, and they had their husbands, and his name was Lot. He was a righteous man of God. Bible says he was a good servant of the Lord. He just happened to be caught up in the mess that he lives in the city that God was done with. And we're going to read, and I'm going to show some pictures, and it's going to blow your mind, of what happened to that place. So those who say that, oh, God's not real, I'm not sure if the Bible is true, I'm going to show you some pictures. And it's going to be off of what I read in the scripture. And I'm going to show you pictures of what it looks like now. You're going to tell me if you're going to still believe if God's not real, or things, stuff that happened in the Bible are just stories. They never really happened. We're going to see what happens. So like I said, God is going to, in this story, he said, I'm going to destroy these two cities. And he said, I'm going to destroy it with sulfur and brimstone. He's going to destroy it. So basically by fire and sulfur, he's going to destroy it. Now let's see what the Bible says. Genesis chapter 19, verse 12 to 26. Genesis chapter 19, verses 12 to 26. It says, Then the men said to Lot, have you anyone else here? Oh, so real quick, because that's the part I skipped. So God actually has sent an angel to warn Lot that God was going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. So basically an angel came from heaven, told Lot, but they came in the form of a person, said, hey, God's going to destroy this. You got to get out of this town. God is going to burn this place down with sulfur and brimstone. He's going to destroy it. So that's what's going on here. So it said, then the men said to Lot, which are the angels, have you anyone else here, son-in-law, your sons, your daughters, and whomever you have in the city? Take them out of this place, for we will destroy this place, because the outcry against them has grown great before the face of the Lord, and the Lord has sent us to destroy it. So Lot went out and spoke to his sons-in-law, who had married his daughters, and said, get up and get out of this place, for the Lord will destroy this city. But to his sons-in-law, he seemed to be joking, which this confirms what I was warning earlier. Like I said, I believe some crazy things are going to happen. And don't take it as a joke, because look what happened. His sons-in-law didn't take Lot serious. He took it as a joke. And how you apply this now is I believe God is destroying a lot of things in people's lives that are on this Bible study. God's ending things, relationships, things that are not good for you. Maybe even job, financial situation, ending it. And God's trying to destroy this, and we're going to see what we can learn from this. So he said, get up and get out of this place, and it seems to seem that he was joking. And it says, when the morning dawned, the angels urged Lot to hurry, saying, arise, take your wife and your two daughters who are here, lest you be consumed in the punishment of this city. And while he lingered, the men took hold of his hand, his wife's hand, and the hands of his two daughters, the Lord being merciful to him. They brought him out and set him outside the city. So it came to pass when they had brought them outside, he said, escape for your life. Do not look behind you, nor stay anywhere in the plain. So the angel's like, God's about to destroy this place. Do not look back. He says, do not look behind you. He says here, escape to the mountains, lest you be destroyed. Then Lot said to them, please, no, my Lord, indeed now your servant has found favor in your sight. You have increased your mercy, which you have shown to me by saving my life, but I cannot escape to the mountains, lest some evil overtake me and I die. See, now this city is near enough to flee to, and it is a little one. Please let me escape there, and my soul shall live. And he said to him, see, I have favored you concerning this thing also, in that I will not overthrow the city for which you have spoken. Hurry and escape there, for I cannot do anything until you arrive there. Therefore, the name of the city was called Zoar. The sun had risen up on the earth when Lot entered Zoar. The Lord rained brimstone and fire, which brimstone is sulfur, and fire on Sodom and Gomorrah from the Lord out of heaven. So he overthrew those cities, all the plains, all the inhabitants of the city, and what grew on the ground. But his wife looked back, and she became a pillar of salt. So, got these two cities. God sent these two angels, get out of here. God's going to destroy it. So, he wanted a place to go to, so he went and found this place called Zoar, which if you look now today, that place is still there, and I'll get to that part in a little. But the angel said, don't look back. God said, where you used to live, it's not good anymore. Sodom, go where you live, where you had your stuff, that wasn't good anymore. Get out of there. And that may be you right today. Maybe like a job, a relationship, or whatever it may be. It says, or a bad situation that's going on. God said, that's it. I'm destroying this thing. I need to get you out of this. It's not going to be good for you. So with Lot, it happened to be, it was where he was living, Sodom and Gomorrah. It wasn't good. And he said, don't look back. What happened? His wife looked back. She looked back. The Bible doesn't say why she looked back, but I can only imagine probably why she looked back, because she probably was going to miss her past. Man, I used to live here. Those were the good days. I miss that house I used to live at. I miss those friendships and those neighbors that I had so close to me. And she went to look back because her heart was still in her past. What happened to her? The Bible says she became a pillar of salt. That was the end of her life. And you may say, oh, but that sounds like a Bible story that never happened. Check this out. I'm going to share my screen because she is still there till this day. And this was over 2,000 years ago. This was before Jesus Christ came. This is in the Old Testament. I'm going to share my screen and so you guys can see it. So if anybody says, oh, well, God's not real. These Bible stories, they're just stories. They're not true. Well, check this out. Can you guys see that? So right here to the right, that's Lot's wife. That's a pillar of salt. And it's still there to this day. And they've taken samples out of that thing, and it's made out of pure salt. Pure salt. There's nothing else like it. So people say, oh, but there's multiple of those things all over the place. Nope. It is the only one, and it's overlooking the land of Sodom and Gomorrah. Well, and if you look at in the Bible description, they were climbing up a mountain when the angel said, don't look back. She looked back towards Sodom and Gomorrah, and you could see Sodom and Gomorrah in the background. She looked back, and look, she is still there to this day. So anyone that says the Bible's not real, the Bible's not true, that's just a story, that didn't really happen, well, guess what? That's her right there on the right. And kind of small, the picture. I'm gonna try to stretch it out. Can you guys see that? You guys see that well? Anybody? I can't see the chat.
Yes.
You guys to see it? Okay. So you see, you can see all of this here in Sodom and Gomorrah. Look at that. Those used to be buildings and houses or whatever. You can see the shapes of it. That's what Sodom and Gomorrah used to be. And the place got destroyed by sulfur and fire. The Bible says God destroyed it. It is the only place in the entire world that it is made out of pure sulfur. Like there's sulfur. The Bible says that it rained sulfur. Well, guess what? Those raindrops are still there. People, tourists, they go there. People who don't believe in Christ. Oh, let me see if this is really true. Because it's only those two cities. Everywhere else around, including the place Zoar, where Lot went to go to, you know, to escape, that place is fine. There's no sulfur there. This is the only place that is concentrated with sulfur, brimstone. I mean, and people go there and they pick up the little balls, they light it on fire with their lighter, and it burns purple because it's pure sulfur, which I'll show you the picture here. The picture doesn't get bigger, sorry. But basically, that's a sulfur ball that it rained. It's all over the place. So anybody that says, that stuff's not real, it doesn't happen, well, guess what? You can go and save your money and go over there to Israel and go to Sodom and Gomorrah, and you will find that place, think about it, that was over 2,000 years ago. And that place is still exactly the same. That place is still made out of sulfur. And even the water by it, which is the Dead Sea, that's why they call it the Dead Sea, no living creature can live in that water. There is no life, not even like a shrimp, nothing. Nothing lives in there. And the Bible said, God said that he was in the Bible, God said he was going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, and it says every living thing, and it says that no green will ever live there again. Well, guess what? To this day, there's not even a little piece of grass, a little bush that grows through here. I mean, nothing, no green. Nobody has ever lived there. No animal lives there. No, nothing exists inside that water. You're going to tell me the Bible's not real? You're going to tell me that stuff don't happen? Well, guess what? That happened. And to this day, over 2,000 years later, it has remained desolate. It remains still. And I was looking at this thing, and I actually seen a video of a preacher there. And man, it just says, God is real. God is true. What really happened is not no story that sounds great, you know, that you just apply in some weird way and it never really happened. It really happened. And it is still like that. And what am I trying to say with this? And this is what I'm trying to get at with this is that what can we learn from Lot and his wife? She probably looked back because she longed for what she was leaving behind. The people knew, what she was leaving behind, people she knew, maybe where she used to live, friendships she used to have, but God didn't want her to look back because what was behind wasn't good for her anymore. It needed to be destroyed. To this day, she has remained a pillar of salt where tourists go to see her. A pillar of salt cannot move. It can't go anywhere. If you do the same, you become paralyzed and cannot move forward. It'll make you a pillar as well. If you commit the same mistake as she did and say, I'm going to go into 2022, but I'm going to still entertain these things that are not good for my life no more. I'm going to still stay in these relationships and these things that God has made it clear he's going to destroy it. He doesn't want it for my life. It's not good for my life no more. And these things that these situations that God is like, man, I'm going to, but you can't look back. Don't commit the same mistake that Lot's wife did. Her heart and her mind was backward where she used to live, where she used to be. What, you know, things of past. Oh, but I have time with this. I've spent years in this relationship, or I've spent years dealing with it, or whatever it is. And has you consumed with your situation? Has you consumed with the past? And what happened to her? She became a pillar of salt. And I just showed you the picture. She's still there. And that's going to happen to you if you don't let go of the past and say, I'm going to look forward into what God has. The best that God has for me is ahead. It's not behind me. Sometimes we think the good old days. Well, I remember in such year, that was the best time of my life. I had no problems. I had a good job. You know, and you think as if those days were the best days for you. Or that one job was the best job. Or when I was in that relationship, it was the best. No. Don't let the devil lie to you anymore. The best days that God has for you, it is ahead. It is in front of you. God has the best relationship. Your things with your kids, your family, the best days are ahead, not before. Oh, but my family and this used to be better before. No. The best days are ahead. You can't look back to the past and say, oh, those were the good old days or this. You gotta forget about that. Because if you don't, you will end up like Lot's wife. You're going to get stuck. And then years are going to go by and people are going to see you. And then they're going to become like tourists coming to visit and check your life. Dang, such and such person still in the same spot. Such and such person is still at the same job. Oh, such person is still in the same financial crisis. That person is still in that horrible relationship. And and you are stuck. Oh, that person never grew spiritually. Oh, that person, you don't want to be that person. God doesn't want you to be that person. God wants to see you move forward. God wants to save you. Though destruction and everything in your life may be going wrong, God's saying, hey, that's the Sodom and Gomorrah in your life that I'm trying to destroy. Time to get out of there. Time to move forward. Time to look ahead. Don't look back. The second thing that looking back will do to you is it'll make you unfit. Luke chapter 9, verse 62 says, but Jesus said to him, no one having put his hand up to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom. What does that mean? Jesus said, basically, who has their hands up? Those who are working towards something, they're not looking back. Because if you do, it says here, you're not fit for the kingdom of God. You'll become unfit because you can't focus on what's important, what's ahead, because you're too busy, stuck on the past, stuck on the old, stuck on the history, stuck on the years you spent on something. It'll make you unfit. When dwelling on the past, it makes you bitter, angry, makes you feel what you felt in past bad moments. You're going to feel those and relive those moments, those emotions. It'll give birth to negative things and emotions that God chose to stay behind. That's why he pulled you out of there. You can't go jogging, go for a run looking backwards. You're going to crash, you're going to fall, and you're never going to get fit like that. Jesus said you won't be able to be fit for the kingdom because you'll put your past thoughts, your past memories, the good old times, those negative emotions first before his kingdom. It'll always get in the way of you and what God has for your life. It'll always be in the way. That's like when you want to move forward. Oh, no, but I don't want to leave this situation because this is what I'm used to. you're never going to move forward. Oh, or this or that is always going to be, it's always going to be something else that's going to prevent you from going forward. And God doesn't want that to happen anymore. God says, man, you got to leave the old and the old. You got to leave the past in the past. 2022, God has something better for you, the best years. That situation you're dealing with, you say, oh, but I had better days before this thing happened to me. Those were the good times. Those aren't the good times no more. God has the better days. The Bible says your latter days will be the better days. That'll be your best days. So don't let the devil lie to you and say that, there was a past moment in your time that was a good time. Yeah, it might have been back then, but it's not anymore. God has the best is yet to come for you. Luke chapter 9, verse 59 to 62. So another scripture to explain why looking to the past is going to make you unfit. This is a person asking Jesus what it takes to follow him, basically to be a Christian. And it says, then he said to another, follow me. But he said, Lord, let me first go and bury my father. Jesus said to him, let the dead bury their own dead. But you go and preach the kingdom of God. And another also said, Lord, I will follow you. But let me first go and bid them farewell who are at my house. But Jesus said to him, no one having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. So you may say, man, Jesus is a harsh dude. This guy said, I'm going to go bury my dad. And he's saying, well, if you go do that, you're not fit for the kingdom. That's because back then, that was the saying. Basically, I got unfinished business. There's things from my past. There's things going on in my life, my situation. Let me go deal with that. Let me live there before I go try to serve you, God. And Jesus said, anybody who looks back is not fit for the kingdom. Basically, let the old stay behind. Let the past stay behind. It's time to move forward. If you want to serve Christ, you want to have the blessings of God, you want the breakthrough in your life and in your situation, you got to leave the past in the past. You got to leave what God destroyed in the past. You got to leave what's not good for your life anymore. You got to leave it in the past. You can't bring that with you anymore. These people were making excuses, in other words. Oh, God, I would love to serve you, and I would like, but I just can't, this situation, this thing, and this thing is in the way. God's not trying to hear the excuses. No, if you do that, you're not fit for the kingdom. Point number three, if you live and go to the past, guess what? You'll die there. Isaiah chapter 43, verse 18 and 19, it says, do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you know it? It will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Let that be an encouragement to you today. This is a promise from God to you. It says, don't remember the former things. I mean, don't remember the, when my life used to be good. Don't remember when I used to have this or be there or was with this person. The scripture says, nor consider the things of old. The things of old, don't consider them no more. And it says, behold, why? Because behold, I will do a new thing. God is going to do a new thing in your relationship. God's going to do a new thing. And you, like I said, whether you're single, right? He's going to do a new thing. Let him do a new thing. But he can't do a new thing when you're staying in the old. You're staying where the things are not good no more. It says, don't consider these things of old no more. Because God's going to do a new thing. God's going to do a new thing in your family. God's going to do a new thing with your children. God's going to do a new thing with your finances. God's going to do a new thing with your health. God's going to do a new thing. And you say, oh, but I was sick this year. Oh, I've had these health issues this year. Well, guess what? That's already in the past now. 2022, it's a new year. I don't have to worry about health. I don't have to worry about dying. I don't have to worry about, all these different things with my health and my body. God is doing a new thing. And guess what? If you believe in that word, you believe what Christ is saying, God's going to do a new thing in my family, my life, all the things that mean everything to me. God says, behold, I will do a new thing. And you say, but how? How are you going to do a new thing? Look at my situation, God. How are you going to do a new thing? Look what it says here. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? He He says, I will even make a road in the wilderness. Basically, God said, I'm going to make a way where there seems to be no way. And it says, and I will even make a road in the wood and rivers in the desert. So you said, but I'm in a desert in my life. I don't see how I'm going to have a job. I don't see how I'm going to be able to live on my own. I don't see how my kids are going to get set straight. I don't see how my health is going to get better. I don't see how I'm going to get a new job. I don't see how I'm going to buy this house. And you said, well, look at the market. Look at this. And look at all these circumstances dictating how things are not going to go good for you and making you think of the past and miss the good old days. Well, God's saying he's going to make a way. The same way he destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, and there's no longer around no more because he wants it done. Well, guess what? When God wants to make something new, he'll be just as determined to make something new, to bless you, to help you, to get you to move forward. So like I said, you know, don't look at former things no more. Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 10 says, do not say, why were, sorry, man, my throat was mad dry. Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 10 says, do not say, why were the former days better than these? For you do not inquire wisely concerning this. God's saying it's not wise that you say, why was this past relationship better? Why where I used to live was better? Why was that job I used to work at better? This place or this thing or that good time where my family was all in order, everything was good. God says, that's not wise. Don't do that. Don't inquire about the past. That's over with. You're thinking as if these things, your situation, the current things of the past, like as that's just the best it's ever going to be. No, the best that you have not seen yet. The Bible says, no eye has seen, nor ear has heard what the Lord has stored for his people. You got to believe that. You say, oh, but every new year, I'm still sad and I'm at a New Year's party and I'm depressed because things are falling apart. You got to change the way you think and the way you see things. You got to believe the word of God. I would say that faith moves the mountains. So if you currently go to visit Sodom and Gomorrah, it is still made of sulfur, brimstone. It is still uninhabitable. No living thing can live there or grow there. Meaning what God destroys, he wants it to be done. He doesn't want anyone to ever try to rebuild it or restore it. There isn't a single plant there. And at the Dead Sea, there's nothing, no living creature that can live there either. Why? Because God wanted to be clear of what he did, what he ends and what he destroys, what he doesn't want for your life. He doesn't want you to go back to live there. He doesn't want you to live in the past. So think about it. God, when God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, if they would have left some plants and some animals in a river, somebody would have went back. Somebody would have try to revive and rebuild what God intended to be destroyed. And that's how it is with God. God's like, man, I want certain things in your life to be done with. And he has to end it in such a way, you don't try to go back and live there. You don't go and try to rebuild and restore and work on something. God said, hey, that's done with. It's over. That situation, it's got to be done with. Don't live there. Don't let your mind go back there. Don't let your heart live in the past. Let it be done with. Because if God pulled you out of whatever it is, or God wants to pull you out, maybe you're still in that situation that God don't want you in no more. Well, when he's done with it, don't go back to it. Don't live there. Don't live there. Don't let your heart and your mind long for it. And like I said, God, he's done with it. He's done with it. That was over 2,000 years ago. And he prophesied. God said, nothing will ever grow there again. Deuteronomy 29:23 says, the whole land is brimstone, salt, and burning. It is not sown, nor does it bear, nor does any grass grow there. That's crazy. God said this in his word. And you can go there today, and not a single piece of grass, not one little piece of grass grows there. No animal lives there. Nothing lives inside of the water at the Dead Sea. And it's funny because it says here, salt and burning. The Dead Sea, if you try to swim in the Dead Sea, you can't swim. You float. It's so much salt and sulfur at the bottom of the sea that it makes you float. You can't swim. There's no way you'll be at the bottom. That's where everybody goes to try to swim in there, and it's so gross because the water doesn't even look clean. But the people float. That's because when God's done with something, he's done with it. And it's like that still till this day. So there's a new year coming up. You cannot drag the past failures, past moments, past relationships, past things that went wrong into this new year. Let it be done and dead and move on to bigger and better. God has. Lot and his family couldn't have the better while remaining in Sodom and Gomorrah. Are you still physically living in a Sodom and Gomorrah? Are you still in a situation or a thing that's going wrong? Are you still living there? Well, guess what? Whether it's physically, emotionally, mentally, whether relationship, friendship, lifestyle, or even a mindset, is your heart longing for the days before and that you still look back to? Well, that's tonight. That has to stop. And here are the reasons to encourage you so you don't look back to the past anymore. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. That means when you're in Christ, you have to be in Christ. You can't be in the world. You can't be living like the world and doing whatever you want. If you live in Christ, meaning you're living for God, you're spending a life that lives for Christ. To say, I'm a Christian. When you say, I'm a Christian, it doesn't mean that because you go to church and you said, I'm a Christian. That means you're trying to live a life that represents, I'm trying to be like Jesus. That's what that means. It says, when you do that, you're a new creation. All things have passed away. And he says, all things he'll make new. He'll make new things. Before I met my wife, I had spent years dwelling on a past relationship that I used to be in. And I used to hold on to that thing. And I thought that was the best that God had ever had for me. And I spent years stuck, just like Lot's wife. I was stuck. I got stuck and I couldn't move forward and it made me depressed. I stopped being depressed when I let it go. I said, that's not the best that God has for me. The what was before isn't good for me. I let it go. And as soon as I let it go, my wife appeared in my life. And sure enough, so fast, we got married and got a kid on the way. When you leave the past in the past and you say what used to happen, what was before, it's not good for you no more, and you move on, man, God brings his best. So we miss out on the blessing. We miss out on the better things, living in past failures. Was worried that this is going to go wrong. Because it went wrong before, it's gonna go wrong again, or I've always been broke, or I've always had a bad job, or you're just living in this negative old mindset. It's gonna be hard to receive the new. Bible says, behold, man, you're a new creation in Christ. All things are done. Bible says, yeah, all things have passed, all things have passed away. Behold, I'm doing something new. God's gonna do something new in your life. Philippians 3:13-14 says, brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. This is the Apostle Paul saying it. He says, man, I'm going to press forward. I'm going to forget those things. Because like I said, even what's going on today in your life, that situation or that one thing you're worried about or things that are going wrong, it says, I'm forgetting those things and I'm going to reach forward to the prize that is ahead. Focus on what is ahead. Don't lose your hope. That's what the devil's trying to do, is make you lose your hope. Hope is believing in the things for the future. It says, I press towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. So the best is yet to come. It lies ahead. It's not behind you. 2022 is going to be your best years. What happened in the past, let it stay in the past. What's not good anymore, let it remain dead and destroyed in your life. Do not try to revive or rebuild or bring up the past anymore. There's a song that I like to listen to. It's because it's a boxing song that I listen to when I train. It's called, I'm sure everyone knows the song, The Eye of the Tiger. And there's one of the lyrics it says in the song. it says you have to fight just to keep the past alive. It's, isn't that crazy? Sometimes you say, but I struggle with thoughts of the past or things that happened before. The song says you have to fight just to keep the past alive. You're the one that's putting up a fight to keep these bad things in your life alive. Think about that. Isn't that crazy? Like, oh, I'm so sick of this. But you're the one that's putting up a fight to keep the past and these things alive, these negative things in your life alive. Why don't you put that same energy and put up on a fight to forget about it and put it in the, be done with it. Be done with the things that don't serve you, you serve your best interest no more. Be done with the things that God is saying, hey, this ain't good for your life no more. Change this mindset, change the way your heart, and start this 2022 hopeful, excited that God is doing a new thing. Galatians chapter 2, verse 18, and this is a scripture if you try to rebuild and try to make things work with things that God said, it's not good no more. Galatians 2:18 says, for if I build again those things which I have destroyed, I make myself a transgressor. That's what the scripture is saying. If you try to go and build and you try to, oh, I'm going to make this work or I'm going to fix it, and you try to go back to your past and revive old things in the past or let the devil lie to you and make you think things that happened in the past is going to happen again and all these horrible things. Well, I'm so used to this going wrong, it's going to go wrong again. And or the good old days that I used to have, I remember when everything was all good, those were the best days. If you do that, it says if you, that's you rebuilding, but God has destroyed. Got to leave it in the past. And with that, I'm going to end. This is, like I said, the year 2022. I believe a lot of prophetic things are going to start come to pass. We're going to see some crazy crisis happening in the world because Jesus is coming back. But for you, that is a child of God, that's not something you got to be scared of. God's still going to bless you. God's still going to look out for you. God is still going to make his promises come to pass. God is still going to take care of your situation and turn it around. Well, how many can say, man, God's going to turn my situation around and that you truly believe it? It all depends on you. You may say, yeah, but I've been hearing this for a long time and my life and this situation hasn't turned around. It all depends on you. You have the power once you say this is over. I remember when I was depressed and going through so many different things, I was in a bad place in my life. I used to be a professional fighter. God told me to retire. My career was over. I was not at a good job. I remember I was by myself, single. I didn't have nothing going for me. And I said, man, this is all sucks. I said, but God, I've been trying and I'm this and that and nothing is giving. But my mind and my heart was living in the past. My mind was, and my heart was not. And once I let it go, once I let all that stuff go, I got a new job. Ended up meeting my wife and everything changed. You hold the power. You hold that key. God gave you the key for you to have your best life. Why is it your best life? And I'm not trying to sound like Joel Osteen, your best life now, but it's because you will have your best life when you live for Christ. You'll have your best life when you let the things of the past, let it stay in the past. The things that are not good for your life anymore, let it be dead. Let it be over. And let it just be done with those past memories and say, what God has ahead, it is the best for me. What God has in front of me, I'm going to reach towards those goals. I'm going to reach for the prize, forgetting what is behind. Forget the past failures, the things that went wrong, the people that hurt me, the things that didn't work out. I'm going to leave that in the past because God destroyed it. God, that is my Sodom and Gomorrah. God destroyed it. I'm not going to look back because if I look back, I'll be like Lot's wife. I'll become a pillar of salt. I won't be able to move forward. I'll be frozen. I don't want to be frozen. How many say, I don't want to be stuck no more. I don't want my family to be stuck no more. I don't want my children to be stuck in this situation anymore. I don't want this to be anymore. And how do you get yourself out of that? Look forward. Put your focus on Christ. Put your thoughts on his promises and the things of him. And believe that the best days are in front of you. They are not behind you. And with that, I'm going to end. And like always, if anybody needs any prayer, anybody, if this message touched you, no shame, ask for prayer. And We're going to pray. Like I said, this is the last Bible study for this year. We will start back up again on the first Thursday of January. I'll be out of town. Unless something comes up and God's like, hey, you know, do one more preaching. Maybe I will. But for the moment, this is the last one. If you need prayer, you know, we're going to pray. I'm going to pray for everybody here at 2022. And it sounds so cliche because everybody on their Instagram and Facebook says, oh, this is my year, new year, new me. It's like a cliche thing to say, but guess what? But if you really believe it, because you're not putting your hope and your faith in yourself, you're putting your hope and your faith in Jesus Christ. And if you put it in him, it will never go wrong. It'll never fail. But if you put it in yourself, yeah, it will fail. It will go wrong. But you got to leave the past in the past. You got to leave the things of old. Let it stay behind you. Your best days are in front of you. They are not behind you. So, and like I said, in the things that are to come in this world, mark my words, next year, I feel it in my spirit. Other pastors and preachers have confirmed it. We're going to see some crazy things happen in this world. But as God's people, you're going to be fine. You're going to be all right. You know, leave the things that are not good for your life. Don't enter into 2022 with things that are not good for you, that you know very well. It's not prospering. It's not going. You say, how do I know if this is good for my life? Is it prospering? God says that he delights in the prosperity of his servants. God wants you to prosper. He wants you for all these things. Make some changes. 2022, don't sit around and wait for God to do something. You make. God says you can do all things through Christ who gives you the strength. Make some changes. Let some things go. Cut off people you know ain't good for your life no more. You know, and move on. Don't live in the past. So if anybody needs any prayer, just write it in the chat. Say, hey, I need prayer. Or whatever it is, or a prayer petition, maybe if it is not even concerning the message, I'll be more than glad to pray for you. And it doesn't bother me. You can ask for prayer every single Thursday. You may be the same person asking for prayer. Take it. Take it, because God answers prayers. We've heard testimonies here before of other people who have testified, have asked for prayer on this Bible study, and God has answered, and God has come through, and God is faithful. So if you need prayer, just write it in the chat, and I'll pray for you. And if not, I'll be praying to end. So if anybody needs prayer, just don't be shy. Michelina, please pray for my friend's mom. Her name is Kim. She just found out suddenly that she has stage 4 cancer. Please pray for my friend's dad, who's in the hospital, and the doctor suggesting a pull. Amen. I'm going to pray. And those pray also as well with me to back up this prayer. The Bible says, when there's two or more gathered in his name, he will do that very thing for you that we're asking. So God will answer that prayer. And we're going to pray specifically for your friend's dad for salvation, because we're going to pray that God heals him and that he gives him more life. But we don't know what God's plan for his life, if he wants to take them home. Sometimes we want to keep people here, but God wants to keep them even more. And we just got to pray to make sure that they're right before God. And I don't know if your friend's dad knows the Lord. You could ask your friend, and if they're comfortable with it, I'm willing to go. And that goes for anybody here on this Bible study. If you ever need anything, you can reach me, contact me. In the chat, you can put your email, your phone number, whatever you feel comfortable with. I think you can private message it. That way, not everybody in the Bible study can see and your info. But you can write it on there, and that way I can send you the links directly. Or if you need prayers or anything, I'm here. Anybody who knows me or anybody that's on this chat that talks to me, I'm willing and available. You can call me at any time, and I'll pray for you, and I'm here for you, because that's what we're supposed to do. In the body of Christ, we're supposed to have each other's back, you know, supposed to look out for each other, and you're not alone. You don't need to deal with anything alone. We're supposed to take this stuff together. Brenda, I need prayers for my mom and grandma's health. I also need prayer for my depression. I'm going to pray for you, Brenda. But I want you to change your speech. You called it my depression. You're taking ownership of that spirit. Say the depression, because guess what? It doesn't have to be yours anymore. You have a choice you get to feel whatever it is you want to feel. When I was depressed, people used to tell me, oh, you have a choice. And I'm like, no, I don't. I don't want to be like this. And I was stuck like that for a long time. But you, God will bring you through it. It's not your depression because God doesn't want you to own it. God wants you to own joy and happiness and peace. And I'm going to pray for you that leaves and that it be done with. And that 2022, you don't drag that in there with you. And anybody else on here that is, I know there's some people out here who may deal with depression and anxiety and sadness and loneliness or whatever it is, feeling like a failure. You don't have to deal with that anymore. It's a choice. You do not have to be there no more. Bible says God gives you life in abundance, gives you peace. But you say, yeah, but I've prayed and it's still there. Like I said in the song of Eye of the Tiger, it says you have to fight to keep the past alive. Well, you're the one that's putting up a fight to keep these things alive in your life. You don't have to keep it alive. When you say it's done, I spent years like depressed. I even contemplated suicide a long time ago because I was so down and out. And people said, oh, no, it's a mental health thing. No, it's not. When I gave and I surrendered to Christ, it was over. That was it. It was done. I didn't deal with it no more. And so this day, I've never had to think about those things ever again. Because when Christ's Bible says, he who the Son sets free is free indeed. And it can be done. It can be done in any one of your life. Anything that you may be going through, guess what? God can get you through it. Do not drag it into 2022. Do not bring it with you. Don't be like Lot's wife that you look back. That's how you're going to get stuck there. That's how you continue in your situation, man. Looking back, you can't look back no more. If anybody else need any prayer, you may say my relationship with God's not that good. Or 2022, there's some big decisions going on in my life. And God, I want you to be involved in it. Because God, if you're not involved in it, it's not going to work out. And that's the reality. In 2022, if you get yourself into any situation, relationship, job, whatever, without acknowledging God, it ain't going to work out for you. God has to be the center of it. The Bible says, acknowledge the Lord in all your ways. He'll make your path straight. So make sure in this coming year, you acknowledge God in everything you do. You don't do a single thing until God gives you the green light to do it. Amen. So I'm going to pray. Like I said, anybody wants prayer, write it in the chat. Father God, I just thank you, Lord Jesus Christ. Father, I thank you for tonight, Lord. I thank you, Jesus Christ, because you're so faithful. You are so good. Lord, I thank you for this Bible study and the message, Father, of not looking back. I thank you, Lord, because sometimes we long for the good old days. We think about past times in our lives where things were good, when there was no problems, everything was in order, and we were happy and having a good time. But, Lord, those days are not good anymore. That's in the past, Lord. We believe that what you have in front of us, it is better than what is behind us. And even things that we are currently going through right now, which tomorrow, it will make it the past. Lord, things, relationships, friendships, jobs, all these things that are not good for us anymore, Lord. Today, we're asking you that you would destroy that in our life. That it would be like a Sodom and Gomorrah, Lord, that it just gets destroyed and you pull us out of this, Father. And I believe there's some people on this chat tonight that you want to destroy some things in their life. Not because you want to destroy their life, but you want to destroy what's not good for their life anymore, Lord God. That way they can go and be and have what you want for their life, which is the very best. But sometimes it's hard because we hold on. We don't want to feel empty-handed. We don't want to feel like we got left alone. We don't want to feel like, oh, man, I'm going to end up failing. I'd rather just stay where I'm at. I'm sure Lot's wife would have preferred to stay in Sodom and Gomorrah out of fear of, I don't know what my next move is going to be if this is gone, if this is destroyed. But Lord, I know that you're faithful. We don't need to know our next move. You know our next move. We just need to take a step forward and take a leap of faith, Lord. And I just pray in the name of Jesus that anyone that needs to take that leap of faith and leave some old things behind, give them the strength tonight, Lord. I believe there's some people, Lord, that need to leave some things in the past. They need to leave some things so it can become their past and not continue to be their present nor their future, Lord. And I pray that they will let it go tonight and follow so they can receive and have the best that you have for their life. regardless of their situation. But I don't know how this is going to work out. I know there's somebody on here right now that is thinking that, I don't know if I leave this, I don't know how it's going to work out. But what do we read in the Bible? He will make a river in the desert. He will make a road in the wilderness. God is saying to you today, if you just let this go and you move on, I am going to make a way where there seems to be no way, where there seems to be no resources, I will create the resources. Where it seems to be dry and dead, I will put a river, I will put life. You just need to let it go and move forward. That is for someone on here tonight, and receive that in multiple people on here tonight. I pray right now for Michalina. I pray for her friend's mom, Lord, Kim. Father, I pray for this cancer, Lord. I pray against it, Lord. Father, because your word says by your stripes we are healed. I don't know if she's saved or not. So I pray first, Father, for salvation in her life, that she would give her life to you, Father God, and that she could be healed from this cancer, Father. I know of plenty of your children, Lord, who have been healed from cancer, and I believe that you can do it again, and you will continue to do it again, Father God. I pray for her life that salvation be the first thing that happens in her life, that you will heal her, Father God, of all cancer, that you would give peace and console any family member that is stressing out and worrying and maybe just feeling so sad and thinking things are going to go wrong. I pray that they would let that go, Father God, and trust in you and believe in you, Lord, so that way a miracle can happen, Father. I pray for her friend who's in the hospital and they want to pull the plug, Father. Lord, the only one who determines whether we live and die, it is you, Lord. So, Father God, I pray, Lord, that you be in control, that anyone who is in that decision-making, Father, of regarding this man's life will be guided by you, Father. I don't know if you want to take him home, Lord, but my hope and my prayer is that he gets saved, Father. If he's not saved, Father, send somebody. Send me, Lord. If Michalina talks to him, send me. I'll talk to him, Lord. And so he can be saved, Father God, because this world is passing. Your word says that this life is like a vapor. One day we're here and one day we're not. Tomorrow is not promised to none of us, Father. And the best investment we can make is in our eternal life, that we know where we're going once we're out of here, Father God. And I pray that he will make that decision and see that the best days are not even on this. This goes for all of us. Our best days are not even on this earth. Our best days are in heaven with you, God, where there is no more crying, no more stress, no more having to get up and go to work, no more having to deal with nobody's crap. The best days are with you, Father God, that we look towards that. We look forward to that goal of being with you, Lord. And I pray that you would take control of that situation, Lord, and that you will, Father God, be in control and bringing peace that surpasses all understanding, Lord. And I pray for Brenda, for her mother, for grandma's health. I just pray for all of their health, Father God, that you would prosper their health, that you would, Father, anything that's irregular, that you would regulate it, Father, any cholesterol, sugar levels, anything, Father, blood pressure, whatever it may be, Father, stress and worry and fear that's trying to affect health, we rebuke that in the name of Jesus. We come against it. We cast it out. We speak your healing. We pray for your peace, Lord, Father, so that way these things don't interfere with none of their health, Father. I pray your divine healing over their life. I pray for Brenda, and I thank you for her boldness, Father, because some people get so, they care about what people think and say, and she doesn't, Father God. And I thank you for that boldness and that courage in her life, Father. And I know it's been a rough road for her, Father, up until this point, Lord. But I pray that she would leave the past in the past, things of the old, let it be done with, Lord. And that 2022 would be the best times of her life, Lord, where she will own things, possess things that she thought she couldn't have or possess, Lord. Father God, I pray you would bless her, strengthen her, Father God. I come against every demonic spirit that has been tormenting her and trying to destroy her. Every day, every moment she thinks she has a good break and that everything's okay, and that spirit comes back to mess with her head and make her feel like crap, I come against you in Jesus' name. I know who you are, devil. I know you, demonic spirit. And I rebuke you, and I cast you out of her life in the name of Jesus. You are coming against a woman of God, a child of the living God, of the Most High. And I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. And I remind you that you were defeated over 2,000 years ago on that Christ. And Brenda is a more than conqueror. She is victorious. In Jesus' name, Holy Spirit, fill her with such a joy and a happiness and a peace that she will laugh again, that she'll be happy again, that people start to say, what's wrong with her? Why is she so happy? I pray that over her life, Father. I know you can do it. She just has to receive it, Lord, and believe it and hold on to it. And don't let the enemy steal from her anymore, Lord. And I pray for Michalina's life. She knows what she's got to do, Father God. I know that she knows what she's got to do, Lord. Father God, that she just puts you first, though. That you be the center of every decision she makes. Every single thing that she does, I pray that she will have that assurance to say, no, I know what I'm doing. This is what God has told me to do, and I'm doing it. That she will act on it. That there will be no fear in her life, Lord, Father God, because you didn't give her a spirit of fear. So I prayed in the name of Jesus, Father, that you would work in her life, her children's life, her child and her mother and everything that's going on with her, Father God. But she has to take that step of faith. The Lord saying, I'm trying to destroy your Sodom and Gomorrah. Let me destroy it and you get out of the way. Because if you stay there, you will end up getting destroyed in the process. But God doesn't want that to happen. God says, get out of that. And that's not just for you. There's also for people on here, for Brittany Gibbs as well. God saying, and you've just been on my mind while I was preaching. God saying, I want to destroy some things in your life. Not because I want to destroy your life. I want to destroy the things that are destroying your life. Because God has the best for you. God knows you have a great heart. You have a lot to offer. And your situation may look difficult. You may feel like I'm in a desert. I'm in the wilderness. I don't see how there's a way. But like God's word promises, he will make a river in the desert. He will make a road in the wilderness. He will make a way. When you put him first and you obey him and you live for him, he's going to make a way for you. He's going to make a way. And you may say, I don't know how I'm going to figure this out. You don't need to figure it out. If you give your life truly to the Lord, you don't have to figure anything out. He will figure it out. The Bible says, cast your cares onto him because he cares for you. Take on his load, that burden, that load, that heavy weight that you feel on your shoulders that weighs you down. God says, give it to me. You don't need to carry that anymore. You've carried it for too long. You don't need to carry that. Give it to him. And I pray you give it to him tonight. I thank you for that. I thank you for everybody else that's on this Bible study, Lord Jesus Christ. I thank you, Father God, because you're good. You're faithful. Father God, I pray that everyone that heard this message, they apply it tonight. Everybody, Father God, and it'll be the best years of their life for my mother-in-law, Martha, for Brittany, for my wife that's on here, for Jesus' life with his wife and his children. I pray that 2022 will be the best years of his life, Father God, of breakthrough and change, Father God, because I believe it's no coincidence that he's coming on here these Thursdays because he's seeking after you. Lord, your word says and promises him that if he seeks your kingdom, you're going to add all these things onto his life, all the things that he has desired to change and to be set straight, and the things he's desired, that his heart has desired. You will give it to him. You will give him the desires of his heart. If Father God, if he puts you first in this new year, and that he seeks after you with all his heart, all his mind, and all his soul, him and his wife, and Lord, you're going to take care of that situation and that family and the children and his finances, and his marriage is just going to flourish with a new love, Father God, and just refresh him, Father. And the same goes for you, Jody, and Andre, a breakthrough. God sees how you're working, you're trying, and you're seeking after him. God is going to take care of you. And for you, Michalina, Brenda, and Philly, I believe the Lord cares for you, Philly. He sees your situation. And you may say, just like the scripture, you're in a desert. But God is going to put a river for you in that desert. He's going to make a way for you. Just keep putting him first. And everyone else, and Kay, Isabel, yeah, and everyone here, Father. I just thank you, Lord Jesus, like I said tonight. I thank you, Father, for this Bible study. And I just pray that everyone this ends this year good and hopeful, that the best days are ahead. They're not behind us. Father, we're not going to let the devil steal from us anymore. We're not going to look back to the past anymore. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. All right, guys. I hope that the Bible study was a blessing. I hope it touched you. I hope it encouraged you to look, have something to look forward to, to know that in the year of 2022, it doesn't have to be the same thing anymore. It doesn't have to be the same struggle. People say the struggle is real, but I say the struggle is over. So you got to tell yourself that the struggle is over. My situation doesn't have to continue to dictate my life. It's over. And that the best days are in front of you and they are not behind you. So I encourage you, like I said, next Thursday won't be one, or the following Thursday, because I'll be out of town. But if for some reasons God makes something happen or something change, I'll let you guys know. But other than that, if not, I will see everybody the first Thursday of January of 2022, where I believe there's going to be blessings and ownership and possession and prosperity for all of us, because we love God and God loves us. So you guys have a good night. I'll continue to pray for you guys. Like I said, if anyone wants to leave their information, I think on the chat, you can private message me. You can leave me your email, your phone number, whatever it is. I'm here for all you guys. Whatever anybody needs, you can always reach out to me. I'm here for you guys to pray for you and guide you however which way I can. Also, before I forget, all my Bible studies and everything that I upload it on YouTube. It's under my name, Jaime Orozco Ministries. So subscribe and hit the likes on the videos. That way other YouTube people can see it. It's on Jaime Orozco Ministries. So all the videos that I put on there. And I think I might release a video before the year ends as well on there. So you can see it if you subscribe. It'll give you a notification. So, but if not, God bless you guys. Have a good night. And like I said, and be excited for what God is going to do in this new year. And like I said, if anyone wants to leave their information, you can write it in the chat. And if not, guys, have a good night. God bless you.